Okay, I think everybody's here now. It's 3:15, so let's get started with a second afternoon session. Thank you, Johan, for warming everybody up. I hope everybody's still awake now. And so welcome to our presentation, Zoo 2.0 in Action. First of all, I want to say thank you to the organizers of a Joomla Day. I'm not sure if anybody's here right now of those guys. For giving us the opportunity to present our product, present the zoo. My name is Jan. I'll be holding this presentation together with Malte, right here. We both work at Ufeme, and I've spent most of the last half year actually working on the zoo as a developer. Malte, you want to go ahead and introduce yourself real quick?
Yes. Hi, my name is Malte, and I'm project manager and member of the Ufeme support team, and I'm holding this presentation together with Jan.
Okay, so while Malte and I were preparing for this presentation, we didn't really notice what to expect from you guys, how much you know about the zoo, if you know what the zoo does, what it is. So who does know the zoo? Let me see some arms. Okay, so it's pretty mixed response right here, so we'll start with a short introduction now to get everybody on the same kind of state of knowledge. One thing up front, if you do want to ask questions during the presentation, that's no problem for me. I think the greatest benefit for you guys and also for us is through a discussion. Okay, so let's start with the agenda, with today's agenda. Okay, just a little slow. So on today's agenda, we have four main points. We're going to have a short introduction, which is talking about the buzzword of 2009, which is CCK, or which was CCK. We then going to head into the zoo. I'll show you some of the new features of the zoo 2.0, show you how to manage your content in the back end. And after that, we go into content building itself and presenting that content through templating. And after that, Malte is going to take over and we get to the action part of the zoo, of our presentation, which is Malte is going to show you how to build your own blog within 5 minutes with the zoo. Okay. So what components with CCK features do you guys know? Johan already said there are 15 CCKs out there right now. I don't know if there really are 15. So what do you know? What components do you know? K2, right? JZBolt? Yeah, right. So Flexi Access or Flexi Content, I think, right? Okay. Form to content, okay. I didn't know that. But we've also listed a few here in our component cloud. Those are all components that have CCK-ish features. We have some of you, you named some of them, those are Flexi Content, we have K2, our zoo. We have some old veterans like Mosset's Tree or Sobi. We also have JZBolt down there. And those veterans, Mosset's Tree and Sobi, they were developed further too. And now are also able to extend the Joomla article. So you see there are a lot of tools out there that call themselves CCK, or catalog system, or directories. Today, in this presentation, it's only going to be about our product, the zoo. So what do you think? Why are these components CCK-like? What makes a CCK in the end a CCK? Can you name any features of a CCK which make them a CCK? Adding extra fields, right? Custom views, okay, for showing that content then, okay. Content types, right? Okay, so we've listed some of them here too. To us, it's two basic points. You have custom fields, as you already said, and it's all about building your own content, right? And those custom fields are then grouped in some kind of way. In Zoo, it's custom types. In others, it's content templates, or you have field groups or field sets. So in the end, it's all about extending or replacing the Joomla article. But there are other functionalities that most of those components I showed you in the slide before also offer. Some common features here. Most of them offer nested categories, so it's easier to kind of categorize your items. We have some form of templating to show your content. That's probably what you meant by with the item views. We have comments, tags, abilities, and we have some form of access control list for the user's rights management. Actually, those are all component. Those are all features the CMS itself should provide. In this case, Joomla should provide, but at the moment it doesn't. With the 1.6 release, those nested categories will be included. But I think the comments at least did get kicked. Okay, so let's take a closer look at the zoo now. Okay, head into the zoo. I'm going to have a quick zip here. Well, what was with Zoo 1.0? In the Zoo 1.0, we had catalogs, we had types, those types consisted of elements, we had templates for showing the catalog's contents, and we had parameters to configure the catalog. All these things were actually not for an individual catalog, but were used throughout all catalogs. Each catalog used the same types, the same elements, the same parameters, and the same templates. It was the same for each use case, no matter what. We even used the same items manager to manage all the items. So all the items got mixed up in one items manager, no matter what catalog we were sorted into. So we wanted to change that with Zoo 2.0, and we did change that. So now in Zoo 2.0, we present our app concept. Now each app, you can think of apps as a comprehensive unit. Each app have their own types, their own elements, their own templates, and their own parameters. And the cool thing is it lets you build different app types now. So because each app type will, as I already said, have its own types, its own elements, its own templates, and its own parameters. So now we can depict different use cases. We can have blogs and product catalogs, and they're totally different from each other. The blog, for example, can have different templates, special templates, that the product catalog wouldn't use. And the product catalog has types that are not necessary in the blog. And the best part about it is we can even have multiple app instances. So let me give you an example here real quick. For example, you want to start your private blog. You will go into the backend of the zoo, create an instance of a blog app, call it your private blog. You'll get an area in the backend of the zoo where you can manage just the stuff of that blog. So it's not mixed up anymore. And you create your blog instance, do some configuration, and can start blogging right away. Now, a few days later, you start to decide to start blogging about your business. So again, you go into the backend of the zoo, create a new blog instance, call it your business blog instance. You get an area in the backend of the zoo where you can manage just the stuff of your business blog. So you have two blog instances, each with individual settings, and through these settings you can configure them completely different, so they will look totally different from each other. But in the backend, we are still blocks, right? Okay. And this is great. You have two instances of a block application, and each of these instances manages its own stuff. Now, a couple of weeks later, you want to add your wines and your electronics, make them a browsable catalog. So again, you'll go into the backend of the zoo, create two app instances, one for wines and one for electronics. In general, you can create any number of app instances for any app in the zoo, in the Zoo 2.0. OK, so let's take a closer look at the app instance itself now. In the app instance, we have items, we have categories where those items get sorted in. We have front page parameters where you can configure your front page, how your app will look on your front page. We have tags, we have comments, and we have the app configuration itself. Now, to stay in context with the previous example, your items would be, for example, the Bordeaux wine. Categories would be red or white wine. And tags would be dry or sweet. And comments would be, I guess, whatever your users have to say about your wine. Now, actually, I'm of a beer friend, so maybe we should change that example next time to a beer catalog. OK, so let's see how this will look in the back end. So here we have the items manager. Up here you can see the app instances. So it's like a tab menu. If you click on one of those app instances, you're in the area of that app. And over here, far to the right in the little plus sign, if you click there, you can create new app instances. Next to the plus sign is a little gear wheel, and there are the deeper configuration levels of the zoo. You won't be there very often. Just by setting up the zoo once, you will be there once, and after that, it's all about adding content, and you won't have to be there again. So as I already said, we are now in the items manager. In the second row, you have the app managers. So it's the items manager, the categories manager, the front page, the comments, tags, and the config. And notice how the items are listed here. And it's only the items of a business block now. They are not mixed up anymore. And we've already, with a block app, we have already two predefined block types. Those are the article and the offer. And you can see the type of the items in the second column. You can set your items to published or non-published. You can make them searchable. You can even enable comments for a single item or disable comment if you don't want your users to comment on one of your items. Now in the next category and the next column, we have the order priority. That's a new feature of the zoo. I'll get to that in a second. And in the last column, of course, you can set the access level, which is known from the standard Joomla article, right? So as I already said, the order item priority, that's a new feature of the zoo. That was a common feature request for the zoo 1.0. In general, Joomla by itself only has one rule of ordering. You can order your items alphabetically or manually or by hits or by something else. So we rethought that concept and now have the order priority. And you can give your items a new order priority. And the higher the priority is, the higher on top the items will be sorted. And items can also have the same level of priority. And that enables us to use a second order rule. So items with the same order priority will then be ordered, for example, alphabetically or stuff like that. And in this case, the digital movie wallpapers has the highest priority. So it will be sorted on top. And the other items will be sorted, for example, alphabetically. And you can easily change that. You just have to click those little plus and minus signs next to the numbers. And without a page refresh, the items, the changes will be saved in the back end. We are doing that using Ajax, so there's no page reload for that. OK, next up is the Categories Manager. There are some new features here, too. The Categories Manager shows exactly that, the categories. You have a column where you see the items count, how many items are sorted into that category. You can set your categories to published or non-published. Notice how some of the categories are indented to the right. That actually depicts the category tree, how deeply your categories are nested. That shows that. And there's also a new usability feature here. which is, well, actually, it's pretty annoying to sort a large category tree, right, if you don't have any nice tools for that. So we have a new usability features. Our categories are now draggable. You can sort categories through drag and drop. So you can sort categories above, beneath, or under categories. You can even sort a whole subtree of categories, right? So this is a really nice feature. And again, everything will be, all those changes will be saved via AJAX. So again, you won't have to refresh your page after dragging around those categories. Okay, next up are the Yeah, you can also drag, make a category subcategory, just drag it beneath it a little bit to the right and it will be a subcategory. Okay. So next up is the items, the comments manager. This is actually one of our highlight features. We have chosen to implement a native commenting system. And there was quite a discussion going on in our forums why we would choose a native commenting system and didn't use any third-party commenting system, because there are quite a few of the web services out there that do that for you. I mean, you probably know Discuss or Intense Debate. And actually, on our own website, we use Discuss for quite a long time, but there were quite a few of complications there. Sometimes if one of our blog entries had quite a few comments on them, some of those comments would suddenly disappear for no reason, and later on they would resurface, and we really couldn't tell why. So a native comment system really gives you much more control over your comments. You can even make them searchable, for example, which wasn't possible with Discuss. Okay, and some users would argue that with Discuss, the advantage is that your users would only need one account to log into your website and to log in through to multiple websites. So we thought about that, and now we included Twitter Authenticate and Facebook Connect, so your users will be able to connect and comment on your items through Twitter and Facebook. You can see those Facebook signs next to the avatar of the comments. Okay. Another highlight of this comments area is the quick edit functionality. You see the green cursor over here, and here you see the quick edit actions. You can actually, by hovering one row, you get those quick actions, and you can simply click on one of them and, for example, delete the comment, mark them as spam, proof, or unapprove the comment. And you can even edit the comment in the row itself. So there's not a single item edit view or comment edit view in this case, but you simply click edit and then edit the comment. Edit the comment in the row itself. And you can also reply to comments in the in this row. Okay. So here's a quick overview over our comments features. As I've already said, it's a native commenting system. We have nested comments. You can also call those threaded comments. For spam protection, we use web services. The web services are Kismet and Mollum. They're pretty neat. You can send your comments to those web services. We have some algorithm going on there, which tells us if a comment was a spam or wasn't a spam. And in the zoo, we mark the comments as spam or not spam afterwards. We actually didn't use captures because we didn't want our users to have to enter a capture before commenting on whatever item you have. Okay, and again, we have Facebook Connect and Twitter Authenticate for your users to log into your website. Okay, and last but not least is the Tags Manager. It does exactly that. It lets you manage your tags. All items in the zoo are taggable. Tags are a really simple thing, right? They only have one attribute, that's the name itself. Now, if you go ahead and edit the tag, in the tags manager. You can rename it to something, and all the items will be renamed too. Also, all the tags, all the items that are tagged with this tag will afterwards be tagged with a renamed tag. Okay. Notice again, there's not a single tag edit view, but rather our quick edit in the row itself. So this slide shows you how to add your how to add tags to the item itself. There's a new tag area in the item edit view. So you can just type in any number of tags you want into that input field up on top here. You can comma separate them and add multiple tags to your item. We also use the script for comments for tag suggestions, hard word, and an autocomplete script, which if you type in a few letters, it will automatically suggest some tags that have already been items that have already been tagged with that tag. For the autocompleter, we use a script from Digit Harald's website. I don't know if anyone of you is familiar with him. He offers quite a few nice MooTool scripts on his website, so our thanks go out to him for this. And now the tags of the item is tagged with, are shown in the middle. In this case, it's iPhone and wallpapers. If you click one of those minus signs next to them, you can delete the tags. And down here, you have a list of most used tags. If you click one of those most used tags, they will automatically be added to your item. Okay. So that wraps up the new features I wanted to show you for the Zoo 2.0. We have seen how to manage your app instance. And now we're getting to the core, which is content building and presenting that content through templating. Yeah, I'll get to that later on, okay? Because it's an extra slide and I'll answer that then, okay. So, content building always starts with content structuring. We already had types in Zoo 1.0, so that's nothing new. Our types are made up of elements. That's our element, and we already provide an element library. You can see that to the right. We have our elements are grouped into four groups. Actually, I think it's five, but we didn't depict the fifth group. That's the other group. We have a media group, which has elements like the image or the download element. We have the form group, where you have any kind of HTML input fields, text areas, radio buttons, stuff like that. We have the social group. It contains elements like the rating element or the social bookmarks elements. And we have a web services group where we have, for example, the Google Maps element. Now, there's one element I want to emphasize on. It's actually in the other group. It's called the related items element. And it's pretty neat because it lets you relate content to other content. It lets you relate items to each other, among each other. For example, you can relate articles to other articles, or you can relate articles to authors. Okay, so now on the left side, we see our type article. It's already filled with some elements. We have a title, we have a text, we have an author, and now we are in the process of adding a new element, the image element. It's simply done by dragging the image element from our element library to the article, type article on the left side. Now, during item creation later on, you will have to choose a type, and the type itself defines the structure of your item's content. So by choosing that type, you define, if you choose, for example, the type article, you define that your article always has a title, a text, an author, and now it has an image. So one more thing, we have already lots of elements that are included in the elements library. But it's very easy to customize that library. to add your own elements if you want to. You can even add app-specific elements that will only work in this app. And you can also override the default element behavior by simply copying one of our default elements and changing it a bit in the app itself. Okay, so now we have finished building the type. And okay, that's just right. As you already said, I was asked if you want to add a phone number. So if you do want to add a phone number, that's actually, as you said, a text field. You could, there's already an element for that there. It's in the forms group. Not all elements are now listed here. Okay, so there's a text field, and you can just add that to your type. That's the easy thing. You can also give it some custom behavior, like validating, for example, that it is a telephone number, but you would have to customize it then. Actually, it's usually always a form field, yeah. Okay, so now we're done finished building the type itself, and we'll get to configuring the elements in the type. That's simply done by clicking on one of the elements, and this is how it will look then. The configuration part will slide down, and you can configure your element here. Yeah, you can configure your element here. You can or should always give your element a name and a description, but there are also some custom configurations options. In this case, for the image element, you have a custom link. You can define a custom title. If one of those is set to yes, your contributors will be able to define a custom link, or as it says, a custom title on the item edit view later on. There's also a rel attribute, and that's pretty neat because it lets you open up your images on the front page, for example, in a lightbox. Okay, so that's pretty neat. Now, as with the image element, most other elements also have custom settings themselves. Okay, and here we see the item edit view. Basically, it lets you do exactly that. It lets you edit your item's content. Now, let me say one more thing real quick. All those steps before with type editing and type structuring, content structuring, you won't have to do that very often. You usually do it once up front, and then probably never touch the type again. And maybe you are even satisfied with the apps and the types we already hand out. So maybe you don't have to do that at all, and you just choose our types we have already given out. So here in the item edit view, you can give the item a name. For example, beautiful iPhone wallpapers in this case. And you can set some properties of the item. You can categorize your item into categories. You can define if you want to show it on the front page or not. And down here, we have our newly added image element. And there's also a new feature here. It's the select image button. If you click that select image button, it will open up the Joomla Media Manager. So your users can upload images on the fly. They won't have to go into the Joomla Media Manager and leave the zoo. They can do it right here. If you choose an image there, the path to the image will automatically be added to the image element. And you see the little preview of the image. That's after that, it will display this preview, this kind of thumbnail thing down here. So you can be sure that you've chosen the right image. Okay. Okay, we have seen content structuring, content building, and how to add your content. And now we'll deal with presenting that content. In Zoo 1.0, you had to write custom code for that. You had to write custom template code. You had to know some basic PHP to do so. In Zoo 2.0, we have a new concept. We now have layouts. and layout pretty much define how the content of an item will later on be rendered in some in different views. For example, for the template views, we have template layouts, where it's a feed layout, which defines how your items will be rendered, for example, in an RSS feed. We have a full layout, which is actually the details view of the item, which shows all the content of the item. And we also have a teaser layout, which just shows a small amount of content of the item whenever there's not enough space to show the full view of the item. The teaser view is used usually, for example, in a category list where you, in a category view where you want to show the items of a category and have not enough space to show all the content of the items. The cool thing is, it doesn't only work for templates, but also for our modules and our plugins. So you won't have to write any, you won't have to add any new content. You simply use the layouts. Okay, now let's take a look at the full layout, which is, as I already said, the details view of the item. Now, on the right side, we see the elements that we have added to the type. This is the title, the text, the author, and the image elements. And now, simply by dragging them from the right side to the left side, we can add those those elements to the layout. This layout has four positions. It has the media position, the content, bottom, and footer position. And simply by dragging, as I already said, simply by dragging those elements from the type to the layout, they'll be added to the layout, to that position, and later on, the position will be rendered in the front-end view. Okay. I think it's going to get a little bit clearer in a minute, but okay. You can define custom positions. If that's what you were asking, I'm not sure. so you can also add a header position if you want to. So that's done through XML, so you don't have to do any PHP coding there either. So it's really simple to add positions to your layout. You can add your own CSS style, but okay, for that you would have to do some coding, so some templating, but that's like in the Zoo 1.0. Okay. You have to edit a file if you want to add a new position to this layout. So there's an XML file that's called positions.xml, I believe, and you would have to add the position there. And you can also give it some meta information, like a name or something like that. Yeah. Yes. I'm not going to show you the teaser view, but I'm going to show you the module view, and it's looking different too. So you see how it's working. Okay. So. I was asked if the Zoo has a concept for the read more button, actually, or if it's a custom field or a custom element. Actually, that's the nice thing about the layouts now. Now maybe I should go ahead and answer that later on. I'm not sure. Okay, so I'll answer that in a second. I'll come back to that. So if you click an element, like the image element, you'll get display options for that element. So they define how the element will be rendered later on in the item edit view. You can define if it should show a label or not. You can specify an alternative label. And it also has some custom settings here again. That's a really nice feature of the Zoo now. You can resize your images. You can specify a width. You can specify a height. And the image is automatically getting calculated to its new proportions. And so your customers or your contributors won't be able to destroy your layout anymore. because if they upload images that are too big, that won't destroy your layout anymore because it automatically gets resized to those proportions. And no matter what you do, it will always look nice. So now to get back to your question with a read more button, we have text areas. And it's a new feature of those text areas that you can make them repeatable. And if you make a text area repeatable, you get more than one input field, more than one text area. So you put in one up here and one down there. I don't know how to say that. So you put in multiple texts. And in the display options, you can then specify which one of these is actually going to be shown in the view later on. So actually, the read more button is gone for us. We don't have a read more button anymore, because through those display options, you can easily specify what text should be shown, if it's the teaser text or the whole text. OK. And this is how it's going to look in the article view later on, in the item view later on. Up on top, we have the name of the item. And we have some other properties shown here, like the authors, the publishing date, what categories it's sorted in. And in the middle, we see our added image. And it's automatically resized to a width of 600. That's what we specified in the display options before, right? So yeah, it has a width of 600. OK. So now I want to show you this same thing for the module layouts, and in this case, for the zoo item module. You simply click on the default layout, and you will get to this screen, where you see the layout positions for the item module. Again, to the right, we have the elements of our article. And it shows you that you don't have to create any new content. You simply, again, you can use the same content on different layouts. And in this case, you see, notice how the layout is looking different now. So this is the layout for the item module. It only has a content position, a media position, and a footer position. And you simply add, again, article elements from the right to the left with drag and drop. OK, and right now we are, again, adding the image element. And now we're back to setting the display options of the image element. And now we want to be a width of 50 and a height of 50, to have a width of 50 and a height of 50. So now it's going to be a little square in the end. And the cool thing here is the resizing is only done once by the zoo. After that, we use a caching system. So the image is resized once, then stored in the cache. And after that, the image will automatically be taken from that cache with each page load. So that saves a lot of CPU power, a lot of processing time, and makes the website, as it is, much more responsive. No, it's good. Text wrapping around media elements. OK, I believe if you want to have text. OK, I'm not quite sure how to answer that. Where's Sasha? Huh? OK, I'll answer that later on, because I'm not doing so much of this template thing, so I'm not sure how to do that. OK, so this is how the image is afterwards going to be shown on the item module view. You can see how it's all those images are now displayed as little squares. That's because we display we chose the display options to be a 50 times 50, and all the images are resized to this 50 times 50 view. Okay. So that wraps up the content building and content showing part. Now, okay. Yes. Mm-hmm. Uh, Yeah, you basically still have all the templating abilities that you had in Zoo 1.0. So, okay. So, yeah, you have all the templating abilities. You can write your own custom PHP code. You can later on choose in the app configuration what template you want to use for your app. And so, basically, you can do whatever you want to with your, but. Ah, yeah, okay. So, yeah, because that's, you, okay, yeah, you will, over here, for example, you have your article type, and you would have, like, an element phone number. First of all, I was asked if you have a telephone number element, if you could write that in custom template. Okay. Yeah, that's easy. You can easily do that. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's pretty much that question, right? Okay. So here's a list of our Zoom modules. I've already shown you the item module, which displays content of the item itself. We have a latest comments module, which shows comments. It shows exactly that, latest comments. We have a few themes there, one with nice speech bubbles to show those comments. We have a tech clouds module, which shows exactly that again, the tech clouds of all your items. But you don't have to show it as a tag cloud. You can also show it as a list, for example. We have a category lists module, which shows a list of links to your categories, shows an, also the nested categories in it. But this is not all. We have also reworked our U-tools. I'm not sure which one of you guys saw Sven's presentation an hour ago. He already talked about the U-tools. So we reworked those U-tools and for the Zoo 2.0, and they now also can show the content of the Zoo items. So you won't have to build any new content there either. You can take your content of the items and show them, for example, in the carousel, in the slider, whatever you want to, right? Question there. To separate tech clouds over categories. Ah, okay, yeah, that's possible. So you can choose in the tech clouds module, you can show, you can choose which items are, which categories should be included in the tech cloud, yeah. You can specify that. And you can also specify if the subcategories of that category should be also, the items of that, those subcategories should also be shown. Okay, one U-tool I want to emphasize on is the U-maps U-tool. That's pretty neat because it works together with a Google Maps element. Now, if you have, for example, a business directory and you have items like companies in your business directory, you can specify a location for those companies with a Google Maps element. And later on, you can render those locations in the Google Maps module. So like all your companies will pop up in the Google Maps module. And if you click on one of those markers then later on, the layout which you've specified, so the content which you've specified, will also show in those marker pop-ups. So that's a really nice feature. I'm not sure what content plugins are. As of yet, you cannot do that. So it's only content from the Zoo, actually. So, and maybe you can work around it through it. If, there's a custom link element, for example. I'm not sure if you can, but okay. Okay, before building the blog now, there's one last feature I would like to show you guys. It's the import-export functionality of the Zoo. which is pretty nice because that answers your question from before, because now you can import data to your zoo and export data from your zoo. But more excitingly, of course, you can import data to your zoo through pre-made importers. You can import data from Joomla itself. You can import data from Zoo 1.0. And there are also third-party importers. As of now, we have one third-party importer for K2, so you can grab the content from there and import it into the zoo. That actually works through a specified protocol that defines the structure of content. So no matter where the content comes from, it will be transformed into that format and then imported into the zoo. Okay, now one more question. Okay, so right as of yet, we don't have any support for multi-language or stuff like that. There's a workaround. You can always build two apps and translate your first app into the second app, and then you have two languages, right? But actually, it was kind of hard for us to implement that, so we, as of now, we didn't do that. And I cannot really tell you when we will have real multi-language support. Okay. So now that concludes our theory part of this talk. And now we want to see the zoo in action. Malte will present you how to build the zoo, a block with the zoo in 5 minutes. Now, our professor at university would always warn us, never ever do a live demo in your presentation. It's bound to go wrong. I guess we didn't listen, so. Now, Malte, it's your turn.
Thank you. So, yeah, as Jan said, we didn't listen to the prof, and we do the live demo. Yes, here you can see I already have a blank Joomla installation on my local web server. And I also got the zoo installed in the backend. You can find it under components here, the zoo button. And yeah, when you click on it, you get directly to the app manager of the zoo. So where you can select an app to create an instance of it, like Jan described before. So you see I already have some apps installed in my zoo. So if you want to create or install a new app, you can simply click on this gearwheel here and use our application installer of the zoo to install a new one. Yeah, but this time I want to create a new block. So I click on the little plus sign and and select the block app. So now you go, the app configuration appears. Everybody can see this? Yes, okay. So most of the settings of the zoo I leave untouched. So to save some time, I use the default settings of the zoo. So I focus on the most important things or the content fields I want to fill out. So I start with typing in the name of the block instance, call it my block, and click on save. And now you have the little tab over here for the instance. So in the presentation before, we had four of them, and now my block appears here. And below the tab of the app instance, we have the app-specific managers. So you can manage your items, your categories, your front page, the comments, the tags, and of course the configuration of the app instance. And yeah, right now I don't have any items yet. The zoo tells us right away on this on the front page. But before creating some content items for the zoo, so in this case blog articles, I want to create some categories. So I simply click on the categories tab. And also, I don't have any categories yet. to create a new category. It's very easy. So you can simply click on the little new button here over here. It's like creating a new article in Joomla. And yeah, this is a little, it's for the resolution of the beamer. So it's normally it's shifted to the right, so it's look fine in a higher resolution. So yeah, you see the category edit view with some content fields over here, the description, you can type in a name. So I focus on the main content fields here, so I give the category a name, call it Joomla. Yes, Joomla. And yeah, please notice the little text under the name of the category. We call it Slark. It's like the alias of a Joomla article, so it's automatically created. It's a unique name, and it's also used for the search engine friendly links in your Joomla. So normally you leave this untouched, but if you like, you can change it by simply clicking on it and change it to suit your needs and click on accept, and then you have a new created Slark. Yes, of course, I set the category to published, and the rest of the settings I leave untouched. I click on save and new over here because I want to create a second category, and this one I call web design, and again the name is Slugified, and I set it to published. I click on save, and now you see the category manager again with my newly created categories. Both are published and they don't have any items yet. And like Jan described before in the presentation, you can simply drag and drop the categories to sort them or to nest them. So it's very easy to organize your categories, even if you have many categories and subcategories. You can do this by simply click, dragging and dropping them. So then I want to create some items for my blog. And this time I click on the item manager. And again, I click on new. And now you can choose which type the article or the item should be. So we have two predefined content types in this in the blog app. It's the article, which contains the text and the images of the blog article, and of course we have the author. So before I want to create some articles in my blog, I want to create an author. So I simply click on it. And again, the item editor opens with some more content fields than the category had. So I create myself as an author in this case. I set myself to published. And I want to have an image. So Jan described the Joomla Media Manager before. I click on select image. Then a lightbox appears. And if you're missing an image, of course, you can upload an image with the upload function. But I also have the image of myself here. And I enter my email address. So the rest of the settings I leave untouched. I click on save. And now you see the first item of the type author. It's published. It doesn't have an order priority yet, and yeah, finally now I want to create some articles for my blog. I click on new again, and now I choose the article type, and yeah, again the item manager with different content fields over here, but I start right on the top to create an article. I call it Jane Beyond. I set it to published. And I want to have it appear on the front page of my blog. So I set the front page to yes. Then I choose a category for my article, In this case, I choose Joomla. Of course, you can multi-map the categories, so you can assign the article to more than one category. Then we have the related item function here, so I can relate an author to this article. So in this case, a lightbox appears with all items of the type author. So it's very easy to find the right one and simply click on it, and it appears here as an author for this blog entry. So, and of course, I want to have some text. I've prepared a little text here to save some time. I paste it in here. And now, as Jan described, and the question from before, the repeat element function, you see this little button over here, the repeat element button. When you click it, another text box appears where it can put in some more text. So I copy some more text and paste it over here. And the content of the first text box will appear in the category view of the blog, and the second text box content will appear in the item view of the article. So of course you can add some more text boxes if you want to, and of course delete them. So I want to add an image to my blog article. So notice that we have two image elements in the blog article. So the first one will be shown in the category view of the blog article, and the second one in the item view. So if you like, you can choose different images for the category view and the item view. And again, I simply click on select image. Then the Joomla Media Manager opens, and I can insert some images. In this case, I choose two different ones. The rest of the settings I leave as they are, but I want to show you the tag feature for this article. So you can click on the tags, and as Jan described, you can enter some text, comma separated. And when you click enter or click on add tag, the tags are automatically added to this article. Yeah, I click on save and new because I want to create a second article. So the second article will be about Joomla. It's called Joomla 1.6 Beta 2 released. So, and again, I want to have some images. In this case, I want to have the same image in the item view and the category view. So I choose the same image for both item elements. And in this case, I can relate the first article to this article, to the second one. So we have a second related articles element. It's the same function than the author up here, but only for the articles. So I click on add item, and all articles of this blog app will appear in the lightbox. And you can simply click on it and click on save. So now I've got the item manager with my two articles and the author. And I want to have a look at the blog in the front page view of my Joomla. So before I can do this, I have to link a menu item of my Joomla to the zoo. So I click on the main menu of the zoo, and I only have the home button. So I click it to change the menu type of Joomla. And you see here we have the zoo menu item type. And you have three ways to link your menu item to the zoo. You can link to a special category of a blog app. You can link to a front page of a blog app. Or you can link to a certain item of the blog app. So if you want to show only an item at one menu item, you can link to this one. In this case of my blog, I want to link to the front page of the blog. So you can, at the basic parameters here, you can select the application. So I select my blog and click on save. And now when I switch to the front page and click refresh, we have our newly created blog here with the two articles. So we have the title of the articles here, the author, we have the categories. Of course, we have the image. We have the teaser text, the content of the first text box, and the continue reading button. So if you click on it, you go to enter the item view of the article. You see the second image that I selected before is shown here in the item view, and the second text box content. You see the tags over here and the information about the author and the comment feature. So the social bookmarks and the comment feature, this is these are the default settings of the blog, so you can disable them for the whole blog app or single items if you want. So if you click on Joomla, yes. Yes, you can. I can show you this. It's very easy. So you have your article here, and the image element, and you can put a link over here and choose if you can, if it opens in a new window or not. Yes, this is what Jan described. It's in the Zoo configuration, so you can set up the display options of the image element in the configuration of the app. So if you want to, if we should show you, you can come to us after this presentation and I can show you this. So. Yes. So, yeah. So we. So for the images, we have built-in feature that you can align the images to the right of the text or to the top or to the left. But if you want to have, for example, a second text box or a second text next to the image or next to another text, you have to build a new layout position. And but as Jan described, it's very easy to do so. It's an XML file, and you can simply add the position. So when you create the when you create a new instance of the blog, you can choose here the template, and when you create the new template, you will have this in this little dropdown here, and you can choose this for the whole blog app. So it's very easy. Yes, yeah, as I said, you have the text, the images, the author, and the last feature of the Zoo in this live presentation, I want to show you the comment function. So I want to add a comment for this. And I add my email address. And write a short comment, and click on submit comment. And now you see the comment is under the text, but it's awaiting the moderation. So you can, you are the only user who can see this comment at the moment. No other users can see this until it's enabled by the moderator. So I can do this for my own blog, because I am the moderator here. I click on the zoo. It's very easy. Click on comments, and you see all comments of the blog app. And as Jan described, when you hover in comment item, you have this action links here, and you can simply click on approve. And now when I go back to the front page and refresh, you see the comment has increased by one, and now the comment can be seen by everyone who visits the site. So this was the last feature. I think it was a little bit more than 5 minutes, but I described a lot. And I didn't show you all of the features of the blog app, but I think I showed you that it's very easy to get a very nice result very fast with the blog app. So if you want to start right away creating your blog, you can download the zoo for free at zoo.usim.com. The blog app is already included. So yeah, you can start right away creating your own blog. I hope you enjoyed, and now back to Jan.
Okay, maybe we should have listened to the prof, because we had some resolution problems here, right? Okay, so next up is the question, what's next? And that's usually the most exciting questions for people working already with this component. So next up is our release of a 2.1, is the 2.1 release of the zoo. And there's actually one big feature that is dominating the rest in the next release, and it's the feature we were asked most for. It's a front-end submission. So your users will be able to enter content in the front page and submit that to you, and you can then later on approve or unapprove or whatever, do that in the back end. It's not front-end editing, it's front-end submission. There's a difference between those two. We are actually pretty far in the development already, so you can expect a release pretty soon. It's going to work pretty much like the rest of the zoo with the layouts, so you can drag and drop elements to layout positions and define through that what content should be submitted, what content will be submitted. Some of our elements are submittable, and that is, those elements are in the end going to be submitted. Yeah, okay, so I don't know if that makes sense. Okay, so that was what's next part, and I hope you didn't fall asleep, because now get ready for some ground shaking music in our promotion video.
Hi everyone, welcome to Zoo, a versatile content application builder. With Zoo, you can easily create and use all kinds of applications for your Joomla website. Let's have a quick look at some examples and all the great features. You can build a product catalog with different categories and products. It has social features like rating and customer feedback. With the download archive, you can provide file downloads on your website. All downloads are counted and protected from direct linking. The blog offers you typical features like RSS feeds and social bookmarks. The comment system supports Facebook and Twitter Connect. You can create a business directory with an alpha index, and addresses can be shown on Google Maps. With a movie database, you can manage your favorite movies and related actors and directors. In our cookbook, you can sort recipes in multiple categories like origin and diet. Tag and rate your favorite meals. Let's take a look at how things work. You can create multiple instances of any application. They can easily be created in the zoo administration area. Each instance of an app has its own items, categories, front page, comments, tags, and configuration. Create unlimited categories that can be nested. Managing them is a breeze. Just drag and drop the categories into their new position. All items can be sorted into multiple categories. You can add images and create tags very easily. Items are created from your own custom types, which are built with form, media, social, or web service elements. Making them is all one click and drag and drop. To display your new created elements, just assign them to a layout position in the template. Discover all the great features and build your website with the Zoo extension. To get started, go to zoo.utheme.com for downloads and documentation. Thank you for taking the tour around the zoo.
Okay, so that wrapped up our presentation pretty neatly. It was an overview again of the Zoo functionality. So we're getting to the last part of this talk. Do you have any questions that weren't answered before? Right, so you can go to our website, download the Zoo, and we're already, I think there are even two apps. So we have two apps already included in the free download, so you can start blogging right away. And there's also a Pages app for static content, like the Joomla article, pretty much. So, so the business directory, that's our paid content, so you have to be a Zoom member, I think, and then you can download our app packages, and where you saw some of the apps there, and we'll hand out a few more apps later on, and so, but there are already quite a few apps as of now. Any more questions? Yeah, for ACL, right now it's not included. We want to wait for Joomla 1.6 because there's going to be a lot of changes with the user rights management in Joomla 1.6. So as we are going to transform the Zoo to work with 1.6 pretty soon, we'll then add the ACL functionality probably. So some applause for the ACL. Okay. So that's actually, Joomla should provide a nice way to for ACL in general, right? So as it doesn't at the moment, it's not us to, we don't have to do that, so we will wait for 1.6 and then include that. Okay. So, okay. Thank you.